Okay, a few final thoughts on filling and just a few little extra tips, things that will be helpful as you're doing this job. First, before you start filling, one of the things that you need to really do is make sure you get all that dust out of the pores. When you sand something pretty smooth and you go on with finer grit, you get some pretty fine dust and it'll actually fill in the pores. So you want to get that out by either means of a vacuum cleaner, with a brush type of thing, but I prefer using a high pressure air hose. And that's not just giving a quick dust off the surface. You got to get down there and kind of go very systematically over the surface so that you don't miss any crevices. You can actually see the dust as it's coming out and the pores will open up. Filling over something dusty is just an invitation for problems down the road later with the filler shrinking way down in or popping out or something else like that. And an alternative to the method that I've demonstrated here is another method where you put the filler on and then sand it off. It could be using the oil-based kind of filler here. There's water-based fillers that do this. I've tried it both ways. I personally like the way I've done it better for a couple of reasons. One is the sand-off method works great as far as getting the filler back off if you have a flat surface, but if you've got a lot of curved surfaces, you've got carvings and things, it's pretty difficult to do all the detailed sanding again just to get the filler off to fill the pores in. Secondly, I don't think it's really much of a time savings. I can put on the filler, it takes me a little time to rub it in, pack it in the pores, and then it's finished. You know, the filling's done. There's nothing else to process, just let it dry. Where it takes a little less time, you just wipe the filler on, then you let it dry, then you get all the time to go back and sanding. I found the sanding time really takes actually longer than it does for wiping the stuff off while it's still wet. In regards to reducing the pastewood filler as it comes in the factory can, there's a couple things you have to consider here too. One is that anytime you add a reducer to it, when the material is packed in the pores and that solvent evaporates out, that you're going to have more shrinkage because a lot of the stuff is just the filler that's in there. One thing that helps that is by allowing it to flash dry pretty good and get some of those solvents out, let them go out that were used to help get it to flow easy, and then use your burlap to really pack it in there, and by then it's starting to dry out. So you want to be careful as to how much you compromise that as far as that goes. If you put it on really super thin and you put it on, it makes it really come off real easy, but you have a lot of shrinkage and you're kind of almost defeating the purpose by putting not enough filler in the pores. So the slight bit of shrinkage you get by thinning it down the way I suggested is easily made up with just one coat of either sanding sealer, vinyl sealer, or seal coat or something like that. The wood, you can fill it and stain it at the same time if you use a compatible oil-based stain. A lot of times on like real dark mahogany, which we used to do a lot of back in the 70s, we'd just take an extra dark mahogany stain and we'd use that as the reducer for the filler, and you would stain and fill all in one application. But one of the things I like to do actually a little bit better, give you a little more control over your coloring process, is use a dye type stain, NGR, Trans-10, or something like that, as a base coat on your raw wood prior to putting the filler on. One of the posts I think Kevin Hancock brought out is that once the filler goes on, there are oils in the filler that will harden, and then that's going to kind of seal the wood. So you want to get your, if you want a nice bright background color and you want a nice rich look, deep wood color, you want to kind of do your staining prior to filling, because once those oils harden, it's going to kind of seal the wood. It's not going to allow the your stains to really penetrate very well. You can, if you thin it too much or use too fast a flashing off type of a solvent, sometimes it'll lose a little bit of its color. A lot of times I will take in just a little NGR stain with maybe a little lacquer thinner or something, and just give it a quick coat just to over top of that, just to bring those colors back. But generally, I like to stain or get the wood color already done before I put the filler on. If you're not using a power washer in your stripping process, a lot of times it's not necessary to refill the wood. As you can see here, here's a side of the cabinet of the same set, and the pre-existing filler is still there. This has one coat of sealer over it. The other advantage of this is that the staining process is, if you stain the wood prior to filling, you get the same color here as you did on other surfaces where you filled, as compared to filling the wood and then sanding. Okay, we're back to our demo table. And as anticipated, we were expecting surface contamination. So what you see here is one coat of de-wax shellac. We use seal coat. You can see all the little dimpling from the break in surface tension, which is what causes these things because of the contamination. You see quite a bit of this. The de-wax shellac works best. You can put fisheye flow out and other additives into it. Some of those cause other problems, as well as trying to fix something, you're creating an extra problem. But if you look at the pores of the wood, they're filled in really nice. But the problems from the surface contamination of whatever was on there has caused our problems. Look at that bottom edge, how much orange peel is on there. But this is all just in the surface of the finish. This is not a problem with the pores of the wood. A little sanding is going to take care of this, and another coat, and it's going to look pretty good. But looks like it's got a disease, doesn't it? Okay, here the surface has been sanded, and we've kind of misted it on a wet mist coat of vinyl sealer. And as you can see, that's taken care of most of the problems with the contamination. Another sanding and one nice coat of sealer to get it kind of evened out. We use vinyl sealer. And look at this surface. It's very smooth. All those little dimply things are gone. The wood's very, pores are filled in. It's very compatible to like that cherry we saw earlier, which won't need a whole lot of work to get it smooth. As you can see, there's a couple little putty spots now. It's going to be ready for the final color adjustments, where we do a little touch up on it and maybe do a little shading or highlighting here and there to even out any odd color. But look at that beautiful smooth surface. It's going to require very little lacquer to build that up. Okay, voila, the final product. As you can see, that's, I have a little problem with my camera light. This looks a whole lot better in real life than it does on the camera here, but we'll give it a shot anyway. It came out very smooth. I think we had three coats of lacquer applied after that vinyl sealer. And then I think we did a little light sanding with 400 and then a little Scotch-Brite pad to give it kind of a satiny look. I think some of the problems with why it doesn't show up on the cameras, the serrated look from the Scotch-Brite pad kind of takes away from the actual look. But the customer is extremely happy. I was very happy with the project, the way it turned out. And if you use the same process, you're going to appreciate your finishes, and your customers will too. Thanks for watching.